We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
The Dialogue. The community voice of Southern California's Young Professional Network. Relevant discussions about the thoughts, concerns, opportunities, and challenges faced by today's generational leaders. Real talk, real people. This is The Dialogue. The Dialogue with Starlet Quarles on LA Talk Live and streaming live at www.latalklive.com.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome once again to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. I'm your host, Starlet Quarles. We're on live at latalklive.com. And as always, The Dialogue is the voice of our generation. So thank you so much for joining us here every Wednesday from 5 to 6:30, where we like to discuss the topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders. And there are several topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders, including our series for this month, Let's Talk Politics. We launched this series last week with our first discussion. We had a very spirited discussion on the presidential election. We had a Hillary supporter here, a Bernie supporter, and of course we had a black Trump supporter, believe it or not, Miss Shirley Hussar. And if any of you are watching the Republican convention, you saw Shirley last night. She was the California delegate for Donald Trump, and she did have her three sons here. And she was our guest last week as we had this spirited conversation on the presidential election. So make sure you check that out on our website at thedialoguela.com. But we're going to continue this discussion on our current political climate with our conversation tonight on civic engagement and the black vote. And if you're anything like me, you are a CNN junkie, and you are up to date and in tune with this current presidential election process, because it's so fascinating to me. And not so much because of all the drama and the dynamics, but I think it's very vital and very crucial for me to be engaged and educated on who America is looking to lead this country in the next 4 years and maybe even the next eight. And with so much going on in the black community, with the intense focus and conversation on black men and police brutality, it is crucial that we begin to educate ourselves on bills or candidates' agendas around criminal justice reform or police brutality and racial profiling, just to name a few. And if there isn't a bill or a law on a ballot that we can vote for that is in our best interest as the black community, then there's something we need to do about it. For example, the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which outlawed, which means made it illegal to discriminate based on race, color, religion, sex, or national origin. So, as a community, how are we leveraging our vote? How strategic are we being with our vote? And if we're not voting, then why? Why not? And so we hope to answer this question along with so much more for our conversation tonight, civic engagement and the black vote. My guests include my fabulous strategic my political strategist, Ms. Kenya Parm, who is my co-host for this series. Joining her is professor and Huffington Post contributor, Tyree Boyd Pates, and youth activist, Ms. Paradise Oakley, who you're going to be so impressed with, as I was, all here tonight to help me continue our series this month on Let's Talk Politics and tonight's dialogue on civic engagement and the black vote. As always, this is a community conversation, so we want to hear from you. The phone lines are open, 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100, or you can always post your comments or your questions on our Facebook page at facebook.com/thedialogueLA, or tweet me at StarQuar, and you can always stay connected to us on our website at thedialoguela.com, and we have a mailing list for you to sign up on so we can keep you engaged with what we're doing here, not only on the show, but also in the community. Now, if you don't know, One of the absolute realest ways for black people to impact change is to mobilize our money. And if you don't know, folks, we are a $1.1 trillion industry. We are the most consumer, largest consumers of anything, anything and everything. We buying it and they know it. So can you imagine the type of power we would have if we recycled black dollars? And if you need an example, look at any other culture but our own. Look at the Asians. Look at the Hispanics. I mean, I can go on and on about how powerful it is for a community to keep money within their own community. So why don't we do that in the black community? Well, with this new recent climate going on, there is an emergence of black people putting their monies into black banks. I recently read an article where there are 8,000 people who moved their money into a black bank in Atlanta in one day. So this movement is happening all over the country, and we now see it here in Los Angeles with one of our black banks, One United Bank. Shout out to Mr. Philippe Darrow. And they are hosting an event this Saturday, July 23rd, entitled Black Money Matters LA at the One United branch here in Los Angeles on Crenshaw, 3683 Crenshaw Boulevard. Again, it's this Saturday from 2 p.m. to 5 p.m. And for more information, please visit oneunited.com/Black Money Matters LA, or you can find them on Facebook at Black Money Matters LA. We are going to take a quick break, and we're going to jump into we're going to take a quick commercial break, and when we come back, we're going to jump right into our conversation on civic engagement, the importance of civic engagement and our black vote. Make sure you invest your dollars into, or at least one of your accounts, even if you open up a savings account. We have to be able to support our black banks. We have to be able to recycle our black dollars, and I hope that this is an economic movement that we are going to start to see happening across the country, because if we do not only mobilize our economic power and our political power, they can't touch us. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to jump into our conversation on civic engagement right here with me, Starlet Quarles of the Dialogue Real Talk Real People. We'll be right back.
A long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my
Hey, hey, shout us out, what's the count? I'm your host, I am WDC. Tune in to WDC Radio on LA Talk Live every Saturday at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, for sickle cell trait awareness, lupus, bullying, mental health, and all different aspects of life. So tune in to WDC Radio right here on LA Talk Live. Also, you can listen to us on iTunes, Live 365, YouTube, and Ustream. And don't forget Apple TV and Roku right here on LA Talk Live, where we're more than just talk. Shout us out. What's the count?
Interested in advertising your business, product, or service here on The Dialogue? The Dialogue will help you promote your business, increase your traffic, and bring in new clients through innovative and creative marketing packages, including affordable radio ad campaigns for small businesses. Go to www.thedialoguela.com or call 323-475-8729. That's 323-475-8729. 323-475-8729. And now, back to The Dialogue. The Dialogue. With Starlet Quarles. Real talk. Real people.
Whoa. Oh, mercy, mercy me.
Mercy, mercy me.
All things ain't what they used to
be. All right. I see you, Tyree. Welcome back. Welcome back to The Dialogue. Real talk. real people. Marvin Gaye is just speaking to us right now as we continue our month-long series on Let's Talk Politics and tonight's conversation on civic engagement and the importance, the absolute importance of our black vote, because it is important and it is powerful, whether you choose to believe that or not, and we hope to convince you of that tonight. But we want to hear from you. This is a community conversation. 323-473-3100. 323-473-3100. I'm excited about our panel tonight. I'm excited to have Paradise because we have some Gen Y here. There are some Gen Yers who are civically engaged, and I'm excited to introduce you to one of them tonight. And we have a couple of millennials, so I think it's important that we hear it from their perspective, starting with my co-host for this series, Miss Kenya T. Parham. How you doing, lady?
Hello, hello.
Welcome back.
Thank you so much.
You and Miss Shirley had a very interesting conversation and dialogue last week. What type of feedback did you get?
You know, sometimes you got to work it out in love.
You got to work it out in love, girl.
You got to work it out in love. I have lots of love for Miss Shirley.
Did you see her on the convention?
I did.
I mean, on the on TV representing Trump. What did you say when you saw her? That's her.
I said, oh Lord.
We love Miss Shirley. We love Miss Shirley. And she's out there representing her party.
Yes, she is. Do your thing, girl.
And we're going to have her back later on this year when we pick up.
And her sons. I think, you know what I did say, honestly, all jokes aside, I was excited at the fact that she has, you know, taken such a leadership role in showing her sons. You know,
absolutely. Absolutely. You know,
electoral politics, and they were right there next to her cheering their mom on, and that was beautiful.
That was, and thank you for acknowledging that. But yeah, it is a very interesting sight. This is really you know, the first time in my adult life that I'm really as engaged and informed in the presidential election. I mean, I did with Obama, mm-hmm. but it's something about Trump that I've mm-hmm. been really watching this Republican one, because I didn't really watch it when Obama, I just watched all the Democratic stuff. Right. So to kind of hear from his from the Republican view is very eye-opening. Yeah. And very enlightening. But let me quickly just introduce you again to our dialogue viewers and listeners. Kenya T. Parham is the principal of KPN Associates. Her expertise include political strategy, public affairs, and fundraising, complemented by her unique perspective that sets her apart as one of the few African-American women dominating the consultancy and commentating landscape. Look out for this young lady in the future. You might see her on CNN, MSNBC, hopefully on
Speak
Fox.
Speak it. Claim it. Claim it.
I am claiming it for
Speak
you.
It.
I am claiming it for you. She is also the featured political pundit her monthly on NPR's KCEP Enterprising People show, and the creator of Parlay, an urban think tank on civic engagement, which is a series of curated conversations that bring together dynamic influencers across the industries. And you said you have three. You've done three so far.
Yeah, we've done two full parlays.
Okay, two full parlays.
And we've got another one coming up.
This year?
Yes. Okay. I'll be able to talk about that next time I'm on your show.
Because you are going to come back. Because you are going to. We'll talk about this at the end of the show.
That's
but
right.
You're going to the DNC.
Yes, I am.
Next week, and you're going to come back, and you're going to tell our audience everything that happened.
I'm going to give you the
entire give us the download?
Breakdown.
Okay. Well, again, welcome my co-host. I'm excited to have you. Thank you
Thank
so much.
Thank you, darling. I appreciate it.
Sitting next to Miss Kenya is Tyree Boyd Pates. He is a professor of Africana Studies and a writer for outlets including the Huffington Post, Black Voices. Sometimes my lips get in the way, y'all. Where he expounds on Black culture from a millennial vantage and mobilizes communities of color through journalism, social media, and education. Recently named Fusion's Rise Up Be Heard Fellow, Tyree was the founder of his own radio show in Philadelphia. Oh, well, was that right? A little radio show. Was it online?
It is online.
Oh, it still is online. You still making it happen?
Still making it happen.
All right, very good. Called The Corner, which explores and which continues to explore the intersections of Black culture, faith, and politics. And due to his excellence in broadcast journalism, he was eventually invited by the White House to cover President Obama in New York City. How was that?
Remarkable.
When was that?
That was in 2014.
And it was for?
It was actually for, what's his name? Al Sharpton's NAN convention.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Very good. Mm-hmm. And I would be remiss if I didn't say that he's also one of the speakers with me for the upcoming TEDx Crenshaw. And you're going to be discussing?
Black male exceptionalism.
Black male exceptionalism. Because black men are exceptional.
Yes, we are.
Please welcome Mr. Tyree Boyd Pates.
Thank you for having
me. To the dialogue.
That is a big deal.
Huh?
No.
You know? He's kind of a big deal.
But all y'all are big deals.
Yes, we
are.
My
whole panel today are big deals, yes, whether you realize that or not.
These
are leaders. You guys are getting a glimpse. You're going to see these videos 20 years from now. Like, remember when they was on the dialogue?
That's right.
And last but certainly not least.
Especially this one right here.
Okay.
Yes,
look out for this one. Youth activist Paradise Oakley, who is an 11th grader at Lawndale High School, where she holds a GPA of 3.87.
Go ahead, girl. Go
look
ahead.
Out,
and
look
is
out.
In the top 10% of her class for 2017. She has been actively involved in youth and government for the past 3 years. She's been secretary of her delegation. This is at your school?
No, it's at my YMCA.
At your YMCA, okay. And in ninth grade, she served as justice in a form court on prison reform, which you're very passionate about.
Yes.
And we're going to speak a little bit about that later on. And in 10th grade, she was in a constitutional convention where she helped to create a constitution from scratch. But this one here, what's most impressed about her and what she's going to be sharing at her TEDx talk is how to write a bill. And Ms. Paradise created a bill that she's currently looking for support from Governor Brown, and we'll be asking her more about that. But it's about social-emotional counseling for youth whose parents are incarcerated. And again, like I said, she is an upcoming TEDx Crenshaw speaker this October with me and Tyree. So please welcome my youth activist for today's show, Miss Paradise Oakley. I'm so excited to have you guys on because there is so much going on in the world of politics and in the Black community as it relates to social political activity. So the Republican convention is going on right now. Have you guys all been watching it?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm gonna start with you. What are your thoughts, Miss, on the RNC far?
The first couple hours of it, I had it on in my office.
Okay.
I was just, kind of watching, wanted to pay attention, and found myself laughing like Tickle Me Elmo at some of the shenanigans.
Okay.
It's really interesting to watch them attempt to spin and control a narrative that is not only drastically different than the narrative and I think hope that America represents, but it's also drastically different than their body of supporters.
Okay.
And so what I saw was, the first coming days, a breeding ground for the record levels of dissension that we ended up seeing.
Yeah.
And, the RNC, we're looking at all of these controlling bodies, right? We've got the Republican National Convention itself should be treated as its own entity.
Okay.
Then we have the GOP.
Okay.
The Republican Party. And then we've got, the different campaigns that have kind of coalesced to hopefully unify and present forward their candidate, Mr. Trump. And so all of these different entities are attempting to work in concert. And what we saw was they need a little bit more band practice.
And with their theme of make work better again, they didn't even really talk about that. All they did was talk about Hillary.
Yeah. So they're trying to, again, concert, right? More practice. They're trying to go off of plays of Mr. Trump's campaign slogan, which is Make America Great Again, which, by the way, I wanted to say last week on your show, is an extension of a Reaganism. Reagan was the first one to say Make America Great.
Okay.
Mr. Trump was inventive enough to put again at the end of that sentence and make it new.
Okay.
So Make America Great Again is his campaign slogan. And so the first night was Make America Safe Again, which is why we saw, a lot of folks in law enforcement step up and give some of the first platform speeches. What's ironic to me about the first night's theme, Make America Safe Again, all I heard were projections of fear.
Interesting point.
And that was concerning to me.
Yeah.
And I know I'm not the only one.
Right. Tyree, I see you shaking your head.
Tremendously.
Okay.
I think yesterday or this week has become a bully pulpit for Black Lives Matter and the ways that it's been depicted by conservative news outlets. Mm-hmm. And the Republican National Convention to me is a complete circus.
Mm-hmm.
And I say that respectfully because I have other words I could add.
I like the circus sometimes.
I do too.
In the beginning, I have to be perfectly honest. In the beginning, Trump was entertaining to me. Do you know what I'm saying? I really didn't take it seriously until
he wasn't.
Until he wasn't.
Until he wasn't.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Until feeling wasn't funny no more. Like, wait a second, this fool is serious.
I'll be honest. I haven't taken Trump seriously until this week.
Okay.
When his wife went on stage and I heard her speech. And I was convinced that this is the reckoning. Like, mm-hmm. this is what everyone has been afraid of. And then I tuned her out because I couldn't get beyond many of her plagiaristic.
I know.
We're going to talk about that.
We're definitely going to talk about
you
that.
Know what it, all right. But it was
so have you been watching the convention?
I watched it on Monday.
Okay.
I was just like, yeah.
And so from your perspective, yeah. what did it look like to you?
I'm curious.
It was just like crazy. I was like,
did you understand what was going on?
Yeah, a little bit. I was just like,
the what world. What did it make you feel like?
I guess that they don't understand like our side of the story. I don't know.
And what do you mean our side? Do you mean youth or do you mean black people?
Both.
Okay.
I feel that they just feel that the youth voice doesn't matter. And then I guess they wanted to say like, oh, I feel that like really is like sad going on social media and seeing that. Not saying that police lives don't matter, but saying that their lives, like, Black Lives Matter, they're going on, like, promoting black-on-black crime against police officers, mm-hmm. and it's okay for, because some of the killers were
black.
Yeah, okay. They're saying that's okay, and I don't think that's what it was for, and they're just, like, putting, like, the police officers above the people that were being killed by police officers for nothing.
Okay.
I mean, they called it anarchist from the platform. Mm-hmm. I mean, they blatantly said Black Lives Matter is anarchy.
Okay. Yeah. All right. And so, you know, Tyree, you alluded to the Melania. What was, how do you pronounce her name? Melania.
Melania Trump.
Melania Trump, her speech. which many of you know, she lifted aspects of Michelle Obama's 2008 Democratic National Convention speech, and for the first couple of days, she denied it. Right? They've been denying it, saying she didn't. It was quite obvious. Although today they didn't admit to being plagiarizing. Admit to it being plagiarized, but the woman who wrote the script said that, you know, she called her. She called and said that, you know, there was aspects of her speech that she liked, and she had, you know, noted some of the things, and she just took it verbatim.
Can we just break this down real quick?
And didn't double check. So they are trying to take very little ownership, very little. They're acknowledging because you can't refute it.
Here's the problem.
You can't refute it, especially when they do the back, the side by side. You can't refute it.
Here's the problem, Starlet. The speech in its entirety. Okay. Yes, the entire speech was not plagiarized. Why? Because Michelle Obama didn't grow up in Eastern Europe, one. And two, because she's not married to Donald Trump. So if you take out that paragraph.
Everything else. Was.
Literally everything else. And thank you. Thank you so much. no, but it's true. It's true. Because you know, when I first heard, and this is why, you know, when I do my work with narratives and mm-hmm. I talk about spin, you know, as a political strategist, this is very much a part of my job. Okay. But I try to pay attention to what they do. When minutes after Twitter picked up, or social media picked up, you know, the similarities in the speeches, they said, oh, it's only 20 words.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then they came back and they said, oh, it's only 55 words. Okay, and they focused on this number 55, and I saw all of these memes on Twitter. It's only 55 words. And then MSNBC and Rachel Maddow, God bless her. Rachel, please, I love you. Have me on your show. She you know, puts the entire speech back to it. It's the entire speech.
Entire
uplifting. And you know, that speech speaks to the importance of what the role and the job of a first lady is. Okay. That speech is supposed to be uplifting.
Absolutely. So one of the things that this conference opened up with is this racist rant from Representative Stephen King when he was on MSNBC and he had made something about Western civilization's contribution. So we're going to play a little audio from Stephen King on MSNBC and his comments. And then, Tyree, I'm going to come to you and get your feedback.
Business, so it does get a little tired, Charlie. I mean, I'd ask you to go back through history and figure out where are these contributions that have been made by these other categories of people that you're talking about? Where did any other subgroup of people contribute more to civilization?
Than white people?
Than Western civilization itself, that's rooted in Western Europe, Eastern Europe, and the United States of America, and every place where the footprint of Christianity settled the world.
Asia?
That's all of Western civilization.
Oh, what about
Asia?
What about
Asia?
What about
Asia? What about Asia?
organization. Let me know
for the history of this country.
Let me know for the record that if you're looking at the ledger of Western civilization,
where does he think he got them cotton underwear from? Right? I mean, we built this country. How could he possibly say with a straight face that there was no other subculture that has contributed more to American than white folks? Are you kidding me? Tyree.
This has been a very long week. As a professor of Africana studies, to be subjected to that kind of like rhetoric on such a national platform completely breaks my heart and also makes me completely double down on the job that I have as a professor. I have to articulate to my students on a daily basis that the contributions of one particular group, and I will focus on African Americans,
it's not just us, but you can't refute that this country was built on mostly, you know what I'm saying, non-white blood.
Absolutely.
Okay, I'm sorry, I cut you off.
No, not at all. I mean, even if we want to just scale back and look at it, the cotton that was produced during chattel slavery, 40% of that went to New York's revenue that funded the Wall Street as we know it.
Wow.
The same dollars and the same cents that slaves produced from that cotton is still being circulated in our economy today.
Of course.
Money doesn't just fall or leave its respective area. And so to think that Chase Bank has the same dollars that my grandmother's grandmother's grandmother worked and tilled over and broke her back over should let you know that the contributions of the of the slave should not be forgotten.
Right, and that's why I was telling you one of the bills I was talking to you, Kenya, that is it possible, or how can we, you know, create this bill to ensure that a Black history is taught in our schools, just like the LGBTQ curriculum. We as a people need to make sure that Black history is taught in our schools to our youth, so that when they hear stuff like that, they can refute it, and that they can be empowered, and that we can educate white people on the truth.
Yes.
Kenya's mic.
Oh.
Hello? Something's wrong with Kenya's mic.
Hello?
Okay, there you are. I'm sorry.
Mic check. Whoop, whoop. Okay.
We're on live. Little technical difficulties, but I'm sorry. Go ahead, Kenya.
It's okay. You know, so the messaging of the Republican Party really continues to push the boundaries of the American intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's really gone some manifest destiny stuff at this point.
Right.
And there's a specific term that we call for things like plagiarizing speeches and trying to historical amnesia. Mm-hmm. Right. We call it integrated modificationism.
Okay.
Right? It's a branch of scientific colonialism. What we're talking about is when you ingest historical facts and they go through this grinder, if you will, in your mind. And when they come out, they are in a morphed version of the truth.
Right.
And that's exactly what we're looking at.
Right.
You know, I think what hit home for me was, you know, what happened with Melania Trump and you know, Michelle Obama's speech, and the intentional ignoring of that is an example of what has happened so many times to countless African American contributions that cannot be necessarily quantified, right?
Absolutely.
In dollars and cents. Black women for a long time have been doing work that they have not been given credit for, that white women have taken credit for, and furthermore, you know, we talk about history's contributions of a civilization. I mean, come on.
I mean, the Black woman on that show damn near had a heart attack. I mean,
she said, I can't breathe in the mic.
I can't breathe. Baby, you know we did more than create peanut butter and the stoplight, right?
Yes.
Okay.
I studied Black history.
I mean, there's this thing called the internet. I just want to tell the RNC, there's this thing called the internet. It holds things like
forever.
Like speeches from conventions past.
Right.
It holds things like.
And what was interesting, they blamed, you know, not Michelle, but Hillary's camp for putting it out when they actually interviewed the guy who just happened to find it and post it on Twitter,
this
and that's how it got
to do about Hillary
exposed.
I mean, for God's sakes, like, you know, half of New York is built on top of an African burial ground. Like,
absolutely.
What other evidence do you need?
None of it.
We're going to take a quick commercial break, and we're hoping that you're going to give us a call, because we're going to jump right into our conversation on civic engagement and the Black vote right here on the Dialogue with me, Starlet Quarles, and Kenya Team Farm as my co-host. Give us a call here at 323-473-3100. 323-473-3100. We'll be right back.
Old time bureaucracy, drugging the
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Hey, hey, shout us out. What's the count? I'm your host. I am WDC. Tune in to WDC Radio on LA Talk Live every Saturday at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Time for sickle cell trait awareness, lupus, bullying, mental health, and all different aspects of life. So tune in to WDC Radio right here on LA Talk Live. Also, you can listen to us on iTunes, Live 365, YouTube, and Ustream. And don't forget Apple TV and Roku right here on LA Talk Live, where we're more than just talk. Shout us out. What's the count?
Interested in advertising your business, product, or service here on The Dialogue? The Dialogue will help you promote your business, increase your traffic, and bring in new clients through innovative and creative marketing packages, including affordable radio ad campaigns for small businesses. Go to www.thedialoguela.com or call 323-475-8729. That's 323-475-8729. 323-475-8729. And now, back to The Dialogue. The Dialogue. With Starlet Quarles. Real talk. Real people.
As around the sun, the earth knows she's revolving. And the rosebuds know to bloom in early May. Just as hate knows love's the cure.
Good evening, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Dialogue. With me, Starlet Quarles, and my co-host, this Siri, Miss Kenya T. Parham. What does the T stand for?
Taylor. What? Fun facts?
Hello. We are talking about civic engagement and the black vote on tonight's show with our series this month, Let's Talk Politics. And I actually have a question for the panel from my good friend Janet Denise Kelly. Shout out to Miss Kelly, who sent me a question on Facebook, and she wants to get you guys' response. And then I want to ask you about the delegate process, just to kind of educate our audience on what exactly that is and some of the myths and responsibilities of a delegate. But Janet wants to know, I will be interested to know the panelists' thoughts on how Trump hijacked the Republican Party. He doesn't embody the basis or foundation of Republican principles that we've come to know. No one except the governor of Ohio and Bush's have called him on it. It's amazing watching his story, and she capitalized his, H-I-S, his story. Mm. So do you think Trump has hijacked the party?
Well, you know, I think...
Thank you for your question, Janet. I'm sorry.
Yeah, thank you for your question. I think it's a great one. I don't think that there was any hijacking. Okay. I think that the Republican Party opened the front door and left the keys in the ignition and walked away and got mad when Trump drove off with the car. Mm-hmm. And what I'm saying is that they really, and we talked about this last week, the Republican Party created the environment for Trump to be successful.
Okay.
They did.
Elaborate.
You know, he is the embodiment of all of the talking points filled with hate, bigotry, isolationism that they have been talking about for probably the last, I'd say, 16 years, really.
What about you, Tyree?
I think that Donald Trump represents the larger white poor majority.
Okay.
I think he, the reason why he was able to hijack the entire party is because his honesty and his crass rhetoric allows the honesty that most of the white majority populations feel about people of color.
Okay.
And so without that anything to be bridled, he's run away with the nomination.
So what did you know about Donald Trump prior to him running for president? Move up to the mic, baby.
Nothing before he started running for president.
So you knew him from The Apprentice? Did you even know of him at all?
I heard him yesterday on The Apprentice with, I forgot her name.
Omarosa?
No.
Oh.
I forgot. She looks like Tyra. No, Vivica Fox. She was on with Vivica. He was on there.
Oh, you saw that episode.
Yeah. Okay.
So but prior to him running for president, you never ever heard of this man.
No.
Okay, so do you think he's racist?
Yes.
Okay, and you think he's racist because?
Make America great again, building a wall.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So, you know, one of the things that, you know, I like to do in the show is kind of educate not only myself, but my audience on just the political process. Because, you know, I'll be perfectly honest. I hated civics in school. Do you know what I mean? I really didn't take it seriously until I started working with my dad. And I really kind of understood the, you know, the, how to leverage politics and just the strategy behind politics. So the delegate process, what does it mean to be a delegate? Who are these delegates and how does this whole thing work for both the Republicans and the Democrats, and do they differ?
Yeah, so you know, the delegate process differs by state.
Okay.
And it's generally broken up by districts.
Okay.
And congressional districts.
Because I think people don't understand how their vote didn't or doesn't count when it comes to a delegate. So just kind of break that down for us. No,
well,
or how does it vote? So how does it count? I mean,
delegates are actually elected.
Okay.
They have to run a campaign, and sometimes delegate races can be, you know, almost as intense in a micro level as regular campaigns. So these are folks who, you know, step up and volunteer to run and get elected by their congressional district to represent the overall opinion of that congressional district on the national level at the convention.
Okay.
So if, you know, congressional district 34, which is mine, ends up going for Hillary, then those delegates are now Hillary delegates.
Okay. So what's the difference between a delegate and a superdelegate?
Superdelegates are not bound.
Okay.
So being bound means that you have to vote as the constituency comes through. Being unbound means that, let's say I can see how the constituency votes. I can choose to not only not declare who I'm voting for yet, until the election or until the convention, but I could change up to the last minute right before we vote.
And that's what Bernie was hoping on.
Yes, that's what.
And
Bernie
so why
was
wasn't so why weren't some independent delegates able to vote during the primaries? Why weren't some of his votes able to be counted? Some independents weren't able to participate in some of the primary runs, depending on the state.
Yeah, because it primaries are based off of party.
Okay.
So
so the independents aren't really seen. Liberals aren't really seen as an official party.
The way that our political process works, and I think that this is not beyond repair.
Okay.
You know, there's some things need to be fixed as folks start to get a little bit more purple, but if you in order to participate in a primary. You have to declare which primary ballot you'd like to vote on.
Okay.
So as an independent, I can't choose.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah,
I have to announce as an independent prior to voting, this is who I'd like to vote. This is the ballot I'd like to vote for. And then you receive the ballot and then you can vote. And you don't necessarily have to change your party designation.
Okay.
It's complicated.
Okay. No, I just wanted to get. I'm sorry.
It's come. But basically, understand. These are people who run an election to represent the constituency that they are from and that they live in on the national stage.
Okay.
And they have to fund themselves to get to the convention. There's no party support for them getting there.
Okay.
So this is all independently paid for. Okay. No taxpayer money at all.
All right. Very good. So in terms of our vote and the power of our vote, what are your thoughts, Tyree? And what are your thoughts on the need to have a voter reform so there isn't any confusion, so there aren't these myths, so people don't feel like their voice isn't being heard? I mean, I've heard so many Gen Xers, millennials say, hey, I'm not voting this year. You know what I mean? So talk about, the power of our vote and our need for voter reform.
And when you say power of our vote, you mean the power of the black vote?
Absolutely.
Sure. Well, I think the power of the black vote has yet to be tapped into.
Okay, very good.
The reason being is because black people have had to always be very divisive in our approach, whether we want to go with a Republican or a Democrat.
Mm-hmm.
And neither of those groups have served us historically.
Which is why I was asking about the independent.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like you said, the purple.
Absolutely. And I would actually believe that independent is probably the knee-jerk reaction that we black people should go into.
Okay.
But we voted Democratic, and so we'll probably die Democratic.
Do you really think that?
I do.
You really think the majority of black people will die Democratic?
I'll tell you why.
I think as long as the Democratic Party stays progressive.
Right.
And maintains a progressive platform.
Okay.
I think black folks will stay in allegiance with a progressive platform.
But ironic, a lot of the sentiments that black people already have are very conservative.
Yes, they are.
Because we didn't vote come all out for LGBTQ rights.
Right.
That's a very progressive topic of conversation.
And a lot of, like we were talking about, a lot of our generation are very entrepreneurial.
That's true.
Right? We have our own businesses.
That's true.
Do you know what I mean? And some black Republicans who I know who have switched, they switched for economic reasons, right? Sure, they want the tax break. You know what I mean? It's more for, you know, business reasons or whatnot. But it's a strategy. Part of it is a personal strategy.
Absolutely.
And they are in that party for their own self-interest and the interest of their legacy. Yes.
Which, you know, which may lead to I got distracted, but being progressive, aligning yourself with a progressive platform, you know, really is talking about the marginalized, being a marginalized community.
Okay.
You know, do I feel like we are being discriminated against, and can I see you know, the harms against my community reflected in other demographics?
Okay, sweetie, what are your thoughts on the power of the black vote?
I feel that we should come out and vote and get educated. So
okay. And educated on what exactly?
Just like the basics. I feel that probably we lack that. Like, mm-hmm. I know my mom for like a Barack Obama, she was like telling everyone to vote. And they was like, well, like, I was like, you don't know.
Okay.
Yeah,
it's okay.
Just like educate them on like who's running and tell them like, oh, look up their policies. Use Google. See what they've been running. Like some of the candidates that are running right now and the president, their policies and comments that they made early on very switched in this campaign.
Right.
Yeah.
And so when you talk to your friends and you talk about voting, because we know you're not old enough to vote just yet, but you were a Bernie supporter, so we're going to talk about that.
Yeah.
But when you talk about just, you know, being more civically engaged and not only in the community, but in your schools and showing leadership positions in your school, because that's kind of where you get groomed in leadership capabilities, right? What? How do they respond to you?
My teachers, they think I'm very like a dope, yeah.
So I know your teachers appreciate you, but what about your friends, your peers? Yeah, do they look up to you?
Yeah, they do.
Okay,
all right. So I was telling them, like, my friends that are 18 or, like, 17 by, I think, June or by November, I was like, you need to vote, you need to vote. And
I was her.
Yeah.
That was you?
I was like, you need to vote for me. Don't think about yourself. Vote for me. Sign up.
Right on.
I was like, do you need me to help you? We have computers. Like, just let me know.
And we do. We need more youth like you to be able to do that. But Bikini and Tyree, you know, our ancestors died for our ability to have this right to vote. And so why do we still not continue to come out in large numbers?
You know.
I acquiesce to her brilliance.
Tyree and I were together at a solutions-oriented event a few days ago that was held in Leimert Park. And one of the things that I talked about was, you know, I think that as black folks, we really have an issue with claiming our citizenship.
Okay.
And that...
Elaborate. What do you mean we have an issue with it?
We have issue with it.
Because we know we're free.
Being free is not necessarily claiming that you are a citizen, because being a citizen comes with a set of rights, and responsibilities.
Okay.
And if we are being honest with ourselves, we are not necessarily 100% on our rights and responsibilities as citizens. I know as a young black child, and I talked about this at the event we were at, shout out to the Solutions Collective. Thank you for everything you do. You know, as a young black child, I wasn't taught to and thank you, Mom and Dad. You're fantastic. I love the way you raised me. But I wasn't taught to identify myself as an American, as a citizen.
You were taught to identify as black?
As black.
Okay.
And not to say that that is an other. However, when I would talk to my white and brown counterparts, the first thing out of their mouth, or my Asian counterparts, the first thing out of their mouth, I'm a citizen, I'm an American, right? And there's something interesting about acknowledging that, right? I have always had to prove my citizenship afterwards.
You know, now I think about it, I just say I'm black too. I don't say I'm American,
right? So that's it's interesting commentary, right? And I think that deals directly with our desire to be civically engaged, because true civic engagement is a lifestyle.
Yeah, and you mentioned that. You know, citizenship is a lifestyle. But Tyree, they died.
They did.
You know what I mean? They died. Dogs were biting at them, getting water poured on them. I mean, they died for us to have this right. And we will stay home.
We do stay home.
Okay.
I don't know. I always look at...
What wasn't passed down intergenerationally? What did that generation... How did that generation fail this generation to not see the power and the pride and to be able to have a voice and to vote?
They didn't instill African culture into the next generation. There was no appreciation for what made you black. There was an appreciation for what made you American. Mm-hmm. And because we are the other, often seen by our counterparts, we never appreciate our blackness, so we never appreciate the struggle that brought us through that blackness and to the places we are today.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, I was having a conversation with, you know, a celebrity, I won't name who, who has been trying to do some work in the communities with the gangs and things of that nature. And one of the things that he said, which was true but disheartening, when, you know, someone had brought up, we need to teach our kids about slavery, our kids don't care about slavery. They care about me tweeting my nice car and they're following me. You know what I mean? They don't have any sense of fear of leadership. The police, teachers, parents, you know, parents are now even afraid to even discipline their kids. So,
because it's all been commodified, right, Scarlett. I mean, you know, now we look at revolution and you know, I love my Gen Yers and my millennials too, but I think that they treat
Gotta get some X or some shout outs.
And hey, yo, love all y'all. Love all around. Everybody. But everybody treats revolution like it's like the 6 minute abs of politics. No, they do. You know, it's like, I really want to see change, but I'm looking for the lap band to make it happen. Like, it's true.
Yeah.
You know, and
I'm not walking nowhere. I am not walking for no 300 years.
And
I'm getting on Metro.
And years.
You know what I'm saying? We ain't walking. It's hot. It's hot. I got shoes.
Starlet, we need you out there, Starlet.
No, but this generation, we're not going to do that. We're not going to.
But we do it in different ways.
Yeah.
And this social media thing,
promoting, getting the word out.
Yeah.
I was talking to my uncle about this. Like, he was telling us, like, oh, they're trying to take slavery out the books. And I was like, they don't need to do that. Like, we need to, like, know, like, we don't only come for slavery, but we need to know our struggles and appreciate them. Mm-hmm. Right. So I tell my friends, like, oh, like, you need to vote. Like, you guys don't know Black History Month. Like, oh, you guys don't know Rebecca Crumbler? She was the first African-American doctor.
You got to vote.
I'm, like, teaching them, educating them, and I feel that we need to, like, bring, like, teachers, and I know I read the Huffington Post. I see some of your posts on Twitter and everything. But yeah, I feel that we need to, like, spread it out and have this knowledge, like, shared everywhere instead of like locked up and like they like try to modify it. Yeah.
And then too, like, you know, I mean, just like with wealth, you know, culture is supposed to be taught in the home. Yeah. So it really is our responsibility to teach our kids.
It's true.
Do you know what I mean? So that you can educate, because I've had many of my cousins have to educate their teachers, their white teachers during Black History Month when they were wrong about, you know what I mean, their history and their legacy. So next week we're going to have a conversation about the creation of a Black agenda, right? And since 2008, I was like, what is our agenda? What are we fighting for?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Civil rights was an overarching, you know, movement that we can all get behind, irrespective of socioeconomic status, because it impacted Black people of, you know, all across the country. So in terms of, you know, our Black agenda and teaching people how to vote in their self-interest, how do we do that? How do we teach people how to vote in their self-interest, and not just because you're Black and you're going to vote Democrat and not really know what these policies mean, but because you have an agenda.
But, you know, Starlet, we have to take a step back from that. I'd love to be able to start at the platform and say, you know, what do we want as an agenda? But before we can talk about self-interest, we have to talk about self-identity and Black folks.
We all snap it, right? But y'all know I will talk about slavery all day long.
Black folks, self-identity is so important.
Yeah, it is.
You know, if I don't identify with what society accepts as the Black experience, mm-hmm. I mean, that in itself is like a basket weave, right? If I don't identify with that, then maybe my identity isn't aligned with somebody or aligned with what our platform would be. And and we need to kind of acknowledge that, you know, we are still disenfranchised.
Yeah.
We are still fragmented.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You want to say?
I do. Circling back to what you said prior, we have to understand that we in our Constitution were 3/5 of a person. Mm. And I don't ever think we really take into account what 3/5 a fraction of a person actually means in this American society.
Okay.
And that 3/5 of a person, though we think it's a far gone, it's still very clear today in the ways that Black and Black people are treated on a daily basis.
Right, right, right.
Civically and politically.
And you know what? And there's such these emergence of all these different slave movies. I mean, I have roots growing up. But when you really
so
see.
Tired.
But I mean, so many of them. But you really do see how just how evil.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Yeah. The white people were
as
back then.
As much as I'm tired.
How they didn't see us as human. And how they can just lynch us in front of their kids. I mean, we're just not a violent people like that by nature.
Yes. No.
No, I mean, I really think that they're. I mean, the pacification of Black America. Is something else that we need to talk about.
Absolutely.
you know, snap, Tyree, snap, snap, I could snap. Listen to you talk about that all day long. You know, and it's very real.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So before we get down to the end, I want to spend a little time with you, Paris. Paradise. you know, and as a Gen Y, I think it's very important for your voice to be heard and for you to be here to be able to articulate, you know, some things that your generation feel. But just out of curiosity, how did you become so civically engaged? Your mom, your family?
Both.
Okay.
Yeah. So I know in sixth grade, kind of jumped in the gun about my dad, but my dad, he got incarcerated. So my mom, she's like, just like fifth grade, I was just coming out of my first year in public school.
Okay.
So I was like going through
and move
that.
The mic closer to you.
I was going through that.
The whole handle. Okay.
And then sixth grade, she was just like putting me in programs. And I was like, oh, like I'm really having fun learning about education and different things and getting like something I don't see every day. And her like taking me like far away just to like get these opportunities. So mm-hmm. I took advantage of them and I would run for leadership positions and just stay connected and like stay involved. So
because you do, you sound like you're a natural born leader, right? You know what I mean? And you just, and you got it and you got it honest. And so tell us about this bill, Bill 151.
Yes.
And you said it's around social emotional counseling for youth. So being a youth that whose father is incarcerated, what are your needs? Why did you feel like this type of counseling was necessary for youth who are similar to your situation? What do you see in your school? What do you experience as a result of having that void?
I know for me, when my dad, he got incarcerated, I would use writing and like draw and everything. But my younger siblings, recently I noticed that when we seen our dad for like after a year of not seeing him, mm-hmm. like she broke down in tears.
Okay.
And like the other cellmates, like their dad, like they were crying and like my dad was just crying. I was crying. And I was like, wow, like we really do need like help.
Some help.
Yeah. So I know in eighth grade, like I lost my great grandmother, mm-hmm. which was like a dad, like a mother to my dad. Mm-hmm. And I went to grief camp and they gave us a memory book and we would have to like fill out these questions like, oh, like what do you miss most about your loved one and everything like that. And I think that helped me a lot.
Okay.
To like get over that. And then I feel like meeting one of my like the founder of Pops, which is Amy. Mm-hmm. And she was telling us the story about her daughters. And I was just like, wow.
And you can like, relate. You can relate.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, I couldn't because I wouldn't be able to express myself. But so many other students that aren't open mm-hmm. and can't express themselves, I feel that they should have that space so that they can express themselves through, like, writing, like, pictures because it's a lot of
and
kids
so,
who have
so,
incarcerated.
So for their, so for your peers who you see who have, you know, probably primarily fathers who are locked up, how do they act out? And how do you think this, you know, getting this bill passed to have a social emotional counseling in schools benefit? How are they acting out without this type of support?
I know like a bill before that we had like to educate teachers like during the summer about how to deal with kids who act out instead of just sending them out the classroom.
Okay.
They take special classes to learn how to alternatives instead of just sending them to the principal office and taking away from the educational time. And I know when I brought it to my school, like a lot of my friends, they were like so happy and they were like, I never get to talk about this. I never get to express this. And they were just like so happy mm-hmm. to be able to express themselves through writing. And they're like, oh, like when is the next meeting? Like I need to like express myself. So I think like it is needed. And just being at my school and a few other schools that it opened at, I feel that it's needed to for students to express themselves.
And so who taught you how to make this bill and what is that process and talk about the type of support and I think Ms. Kenya has a question for you afterward, but talk about the type of support that you received. Tell us a little bit about the bill and what stage are you at with it?
So the Weingar YMCA, shout them out. They have the youth in government. So I've been doing that program. This September will be my fourth year, and I'll be a senior from the program. And basically, you have to work as a delegation and create a bill that you want to see implemented in your community. And you just write it, and you have to research it and do pros and cons speeches back and forth with your whole delegation. So, like, I'll be pro, you'll be con, pro, con. And we have to say it to our advisors and get feedback, like, oh, like, you need to, like, understand, because we are African American. So some of the topics will be like, oh, like, youth and government's mostly Caucasian. So, like, how you're going to articulate yourself, and you have to know how to be diversified and get your point across. So passing the bill that POPS, not POPS, but social emotional counseling for high school students, I thought it would be really hard, but it wasn't that hard.
Okay.
So, like, being in our committee, it was diversified, but they were all, like, with me, and I was like.
And you said, and what type of support have you gotten on it so far?
Oh, a lot of my friends, they have supported me. A lot of, for youth and government, the youth and governor, the youth governor, Jerry Brown, he came to our youth and government in Sacramento the year before. So I believe it got signed in our delegation. So we'll be going in the process of going to
adopt it. Kenya, you had a question?
No, you know, I just wanted to celebrate her. I just wanted to
give her a clap.
No, really, I just wanted to celebrate her because it's so important. You talk about civic engagement for our youth to understand governance at a very early age, because, you know, politics is all around us. Mm-hmm. It's not just electoral. It's in the workplace. Mm-hmm. It's in college when you're there. You know, anytime you are having to negotiate your space in any arena, you know, you have to play politics.
Right.
And understanding governance is so a part of that. And I just want to celebrate you, because the tools that you are learning right now are going to serve you exponentially.
Absolutely.
As you ascend. And I'm just so excited for you.
And that's one of the things that I see that we lost, you know, from the civil rights movement, because we had Saturday schools, right, with the Black Panthers, and they were teaching the kids the history and about the laws the freedom schools, absolutely.
Which are still kicking. Shout out to CDF, freedom schools.
Yes.
Both Tyree and I were.
Alex Johnson, shout out.
Yes, shout out. Sandra Chase, love you, girl. Shout out.
But we need those type of schools. I mean, if we can't get it implemented, because I know I have a goddaughter who's in a predominantly white private school, and she goes to Korean school, because everybody in her school are almost Korean, you know, are Korean. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? And they have their own. They have Saturday schools. You know, the Jewish kids go to school on Saturdays to learn about their culture and their history. And so that's something, if it's not going to be done in law, that we as a community need to pick up and be able to educate our youth and have some sense of pride and self and who they are. You were a Bernie supporter. What was it about Bernie that you liked?
I think his, like, issues for, like, education, that was really touching. About to go college. Uh-huh. It's like for free. Possibly for free.
Uh-huh.
And then just him, like, as a person and his ideas, I feel like he was going to take us to the next level.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like we would have had, like, some.
And you said you had there was some internal stuff going on in your house, because your mama was going for Hillary and y'all were beefing.
She still is.
You looking around like she going to come around the corner.
She might.
Like, the door's locked, sweetie. Don't worry. We got you.
Yeah.
How was that type of conversation, you and your mom? You're a Bernie supporter. And what is it about Hillary that you don't like or you didn't really fully want to support?
She ain't trying to go on record. Look at her. Look at you pressuring the baby.
She still
got to
get your bill passed. She
said, I still need bipartisan.
Yeah. She's okay.
She's okay. Okay, so we're going to talk about.
Are you with her? Are you with her now?
You got to be with her now.
Yeah.
Well, you
don't
have to be.
Yeah, Bernie. You know Hillary?
You can work it out.
Okay,
you can work it out. Have your agenda ready for Hillary.
Gen Y for Hillary.
Right.
Amen.
Yes.
You know what amen,
mean?
Amen.
Because
not,
we
not
have
Trump.
We no. do have some leverage here, because the black issue is on the minds and tongues of white people across the country.
Yes.
And we have an opportunity to leverage it to our advantage, but we have to have an agenda. We have to be strategic. And we're going to talk about disrupting the system when we come back from our commercial break, and what that looks like, not only with our voice, but what are we doing in terms of protesting and this marching? Because like a good friend of mine once told me, if you're marching without a plan, then you're just walking. right? And we can't just walk. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about it when we get back. We'll be right back.
Did you know that life is giving love a guarantee to last you forever and another day? Just as time knew to move on since the beginning, and the seasons know exactly when to change. Just as kindness knows no shame, nothing for your joy and pain. But I'll be loving you always. As today I know I'm living, but tomorrow would make me the past, for that I mustn't fear. For I'll know deep in my mind the love of me I've left behind. Cause I'll be loving you always.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Inviting you to join us every Thursday, 1 p.m. Pacific, for Cool Classics. Join us as we discuss classical cool in the arts, what has happened, what is happening, and what will happen. So don't forget to tune in to Cool Classics every Thursday, 1 p.m. Pacific, exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Radio Flag, TuneIn Radio, AHA Radio, TiVo Radio, and Apple TV Radio. Or just watch and listen directly at Cool Classics on LATalkLive.com. Classic radio handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and this is Frank,
and this is Ruslan,
and we are more than just talk.
Hey, hey, shout us out, what's the count? I'm your host, I am WDC. Tune in to WDC Radio on LA Talk Live every Saturday at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, for sickle cell trait awareness, lupus, bullying, mental health, and all different aspects of life. So tune in to WDC Radio right here on LA Talk Live. Also, you can listen to us on iTunes, Live 365, YouTube, and Ustream. And don't forget Apple TV and Roku right here on LA Talk Live, where we're more than just talk. Shout us out. What's the count?
Understand, this is for all of my ancestors who were raped, who were killed, and hung because of their plight for freedom and for dignity. They died for me, and they died for you. This is for them. To know that, yes, even today, in 1992, we are still fired up, and we're still talking about revolution.
A revolution. We were talking about it in 1992, and we need, apparently, we still need to talk about it in 2016. Welcome back to the Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. I'm your host, Starlet Quarles, and we are continuing our month-long series on Let's Talk Politics, and tonight's conversation on civic engagement and the black vote and the power and the importance of not only mobilizing our dollar, but mobilizing our vote in a strategic manner. And Kenya, before we went to the commercial break, I mentioned you had, during one of our pre-interviews, you had mentioned that black people need to disrupt the system. And we have historically been disrupting the system. But in terms of today's age, especially when it comes to social media, what does that look like to you? What does it look like for us to disrupt the system?
So, okay, book plug.
Okay.
If you have not read W.E.B. Du Bois, The Souls of Black Folk, you need to read it.
Okay.
You have to read it. Mm-hmm. And in that book, he asks a pivotal question. I talked about this the other night, The Soulful Collective.
Okay.
He asks black folks, how does it feel to be a problem? And that question is less about acknowledging the problematic nature of your existence and more a challenge to say, what kind of a problem do you want to be?
Okay.
And, you know, when you talked about, you know, what is the whole purpose of this, you know, of conventions and delegates and all of that, you know, all of, you know, the whole primary system, it's a long season. You know, the architects of our Constitution, while they were extremely racist, were also brilliant.
Okay.
And they actually built revolution into the Constitution. That's why we have things like, you know, amendments and bills and, you know, add-ons and ways that we can kind of shape and mold this to fit our the framework that reflects America as America changes.
Okay.
But the problem is that, you know, we as Black folks need to kind of figure out how we want to impact this malleable thing called the American democracy and figure out whose problem and what kind of a problem we want to be in. And for me, you know, that manifests itself in, you know, being a disruption to the system. You know, we were originally brought here of 400,000. We are now 37 million. To me, that itself is a problem. And that's a problem I'm proud of. That's a disruption I'm proud of. We are no longer enslaved. Peoples, I'm proud of that problem. You know, as consumers, though, we are, as you stated, you know, those hard-hitting numbers in the beginning of our show.
$1.1 trillion.
To me, that's a problem that we are not in control of yet.
Right.
So we need to decide what kind of a problem do we want to be and what kind of a disruption to the system do we want to be.
And we've seen their playbook, right? We already know what they're going to do. We've seen the counterintelligence, you know, counterintelligence pro thing that they did with, you know, the Black Panthers. We know that they're going to try to divide and conquer. We've seen them attempt to take our fathers out of our communities, right? You know what I mean?
So they've done it.
They've done it. So I'm just saying, but we know what they're going to attempt to do.
Absolutely.
So we've been educated. We've been gone to college. So at what point do we flip the script and do we, you know, kind of use their tools and their strategies against them? Tyree,
go ahead.
If I can, the moment that we want to, the ways that we can change this system and become a disruption is when we decide to create a large exodus from the system itself.
Very good.
And if we create this exodus and we start to coalesce and mobilize and organize ourselves culturally, culturally and otherwise, we can create a politic, an agenda that will literally change the face of this nation, because we as the nation being, I think we are 14% of the population.
Yeah, 13.
13. Thank you. Thank you for correcting. 13% of the population, if we coalesce and organize, we could be a powerful voting bloc.
Absolutely.
That literally can swing the pendulum of the democracy.
Absolutely.
Either left or right.
In the state of California, you know, we are about 12.7% of the population in the state of California, but we vote at 19%. So you already see in the state of California the impact that we can have, right?
Absolutely.
The Black population has been shown to sway and determine elections.
Absolutely.
So
Tyree, I want to ask you about the history and the impact of Black social mobility.
Oh, yeah. Great. Thank you for that. I've been looking forward to this because social mobility became a large conversation for Black people after integration.
Okay.
And Black people have been trying to integrate into this society for ever since 1619 when we got dropped here in Virginia.
Okay.
But our social mobility has always been, you know, very dictated by the powers that be. And so when integration came about in the 1950s and 60s and Martin Luther King was successful in 64, Black people had their promised land moment.
Okay.
We believed that we had finally ascended, we'd finally reached the social promised land, and that we could walk in.
Okay.
But when we looked over the mountaintop, we found out it wasn't very pretty for us still.
No, no.
And there were still giants in the valley and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And this social mobility created two camps.
Okay.
And those two camps, one who happens to be the bourgeoisie, went one direction.
Okay.
And those who are the lower social class went in another direction.
Okay.
But the problem has always been the same for Black people, because it's always been two camps. And those two camps have been the House Negro and the Field Negro.
Right.
I've been reading a lot of Malcolm X, who talks about this divide for the Black agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And the House Negro, who anyone who might know history, will always be the one who acquiesces to the master's demands, while the Field Negro is one who's interested in complete revolution.
Okay.
And we still have that divide. And so those who have influence, the bourgeoisie, the upper middle class of Black people, still have to reject the house Negro syndrome
Absolutely.
At the expense of liberation of Black
Absolutely.
People as a whole.
Absolutely.
And we talked about this again too, you know, that's why I love this brother right here.
Thank you so much.
I love this brother, right? I could talk to him all day.
Thank you.
You know, we have to be really careful as Black folks how we police the boundaries of our Blackness too, because specifically
I agree.
That comment that he's making about the split much of that split was an extension of white supremacy. Okay. We need to acknowledge that, right? Yeah. I mean, you know, there's a reason why I look this way, mm-hmm. because black folks in my family on my mother's side intentionally married and had children with other black folks who were lighter so that their children could pass.
Okay.
At least you're honest about it.
Listen.
That's powerful.
At least you're honest about it.
That's powerful.
It's true.
I was picking some cotton. I know my people was picking.
People, but I mean, here's the thing, right? Like I am a product of both.
Okay.
Right. Absolutely. Like I am a product of both. And we have to be very careful though, internally as black folks, how we police the boundaries of our blackness.
Right. And you're absolutely right, because, you know, black people don't want not only to get checked by white people, but they don't want to get checked by us either.
No.
You know what I'm saying? By each other. So right. We need to be able to, yes, paradise. Oh. You need to be able to, no, if we can't hear it, if you don't want to hear it from white folks, we at least got to be able to check each other.
Absolutely.
Right. And because when we talk about, media. Because when we talk about, right, black Twitter is a trip, right?
We drag
but when we talk about, you know, black businesses and supporting black businesses, yeah. while we need to do that, we need to up our customer service too. Do you know what I'm saying?
Listen,
there's some things that we need to do if you want, because we're spoiled with this bourgeoisie. We didn't been to Nordstrom's, right? We know we can take back some shoes.
Well, but Starlet, you know, and out of love, I want to be careful with that, because, you know, I don't believe that being excellent is being bourgeois.
No. I'm just saying. I use that creatively, but there have been, and even if you're not bourgeois, you know what I mean? And I consider myself bourgeois. I feel like I'm in the middle. I got a little ghetto up in me. But I like customer service. Whether you're black, white, you know what I mean? I'm tipping you because you didn't just show up to work.
Absolutely.
Do you know what I mean? You mm-hmm. came, you checked mm-hmm. up on me, and we mm-hmm. tend to have lower expectations when we go to black-owned businesses.
Absolutely.
Well, if you want me to continue to support your business, and I don't have a problem doing that,
right.
But let's just have some reciprocity here.
Absolutely.
Do you know what I'm saying? And this is up our expectations of each other so that we can trust, because we do have a trust issue in the black community when it comes to investing and when it comes to supporting. We still feel like white folks' ice is colder sometimes.
I have a question for Brother Tyree. Okay.
Oh, please. Thank you. But I like that metaphor. Ice is colder.
I like that.
Take it out with me. Sorry.
What is your... Can you talk a little bit more about, you know, this split? Because mm-hmm. I feel like we are really looking at quite a juxtaposition of being black in America, particularly as we are leaving, or our first black president is leaving his mm-hmm. Tenure, what I think has been an excellent, awesome tenure. You know, we were talking the other night about, you know, these two different images of blackness that we've mm-hmm. seen in the last 8 years, right? I've gone from seeing black folks being identified as refugees, standing on tops of their homes, waving American flags, those flags who were given to them by, you know, a government to honor their family members who gave their lives, right? They were service members. That's where you get those big flags from. So they're waving them on the top of their roofs, to 3 years later, us waving flags, being proud of to be American, to elect our first black president. Is that split, you know, representative or emblematic of, you know, kind of a different segments of where we are? You know, we're calling out as an SOS, and then we're also trying to figure out how we can be proud in this, you know, American tapestry.
I would say it's not emblematic, it's mm-hmm. symptomatic.
Symptomatic. Yeah.
Symptomatic of white supremacy, as you were saying earlier, and symptomatic of a larger cancer that American and black people face in this mm-hmm. country. Racism still plays a role in the social mobility that we have or don't have, because life chances are afforded to people based off of their zip code.
Yeah.
If you live in Ladera Heights, you will probably go further. You will probably have a college education. You will probably own one of those homes in those neighborhoods. But if you live in Imperial Courts, or if you live in the jungles, you'll probably stay in the jungles and in Imperial Courts for the rest of your life.
Right.
But and that creates the two diverging camps, one where circumstances create the house Negro mm-hmm. and context create the house Negro. And then another context creates creates the field Negro. And the other one creates the house, because mm-hmm. I mean, you ain't going to leave your comfort of your home if it's plush and nice to go on the front.
But we need to bring some more spooks by the door, right?
We need to bring back some more spooks by the door.
But Tyree, I want to spend a little more time with you.
Hope that answers your question.
It does.
So I want you to talk about the importance of social media and how it's impacted our ability to mobilize as black people.
Absolutely. So, as you all know, follow me on Twitter,
Tyree BP.
Follow me. I have been on Twitter for several years and have been really active, mostly from the Ferguson era. So that was 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And I remember how I watched the Michael Brown unfolding in front of my face on this cell phone,
yeah,
on my timeline. And for that whole summer, I just spent tweeting and reporting and connecting with people who were on the ground and throughout the country. And it taught me something.
Mm-hmm.
It taught me that I was in a long tradition of blackness, okay, that I had never known I was actually, mm-hmm, a part of.
Mm-hmm.
And that tradition is one where we create counter spaces, mm-hmm, for ourselves when narratives from our experiences are bridled by other groups.
Okay.
And so Black Twitter is that counter space. Mm-hmm. Just like the barbershop is a counter space and the salon is a counter space. Social media is an extension of the communications that we, mm-hmm, have amongst ourselves.
Okay.
So when we say one thing in one space, everybody in the room knows what we're talking about. Like, it's lit.
Right.
We don't know where, how that started. We don't know who started
code switching
it, but we all know, yeah, mm-hmm, what it means.
Yeah.
On Fleek, we don't know, but we don't know what it, yeah, is or who actually originated, but we know the connotation.
Yeah.
And that is based off cultural context that we can't ignore.
Okay.
And social media is an extension of,
absolutely,
that social context.
And so we talked about the Black Lives Matter movement.
Yes,
and like
we did.
I had mentioned before, you know, in our conversation, I completely support. I don't want anybody to think that I don't support Black Lives Matter movement and what,
yes,
they're doing. I think it's great that we're keeping, you know, police brutality and, you know, criminal justice reform on the minds and lips of white people. My only
been to a meeting?
But my only challenge, and I have not. But
I'm just inviting you to go to a meeting.
But
you're always invited.
But I have absolutely no problem coming to a meeting. And trust me. But my only question is, you know, where are we going after we march? You know, mm, I mean, is there something that we can vote on?
Mm.
Is there some, you know, I mean, because like I said, you know, marching and protesting without a plan, we're just walking.
Right.
So is the Black Lives Matter movement, is it going to end with us being able to vote on something? Because I need for the Black Lives Matter movement to appeal to my father, who is going to vote.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So he's not going to get out there and march,
right,
but to be able to appeal and to be able to, you know, give people opportunities to support it in different ways other than marching, other than money, other, mm, than they'll vote. So
right,
if Black Lives Matter is going to, if they're trying to put together some policy, especially here in LA, I only know what really LA, mm, is doing. And
it's
the
founding chapter.
Okay.
It is. Mm-hmm. Born and bred.
So, so is there the policy coming? Is there a bill? Talk to me.
I can answer it. So let me make a large distinction about Black Lives Matter. So
okay,
we have Black Lives Matter, the organization, and then we have Black Lives Matter, the movement.
Okay.
They're often conflated, but they're two very different things. What we see on a daily basis, when you see that slogan or that hashtag, that's the larger movement. There's,
okay,
people who are involved in that.
And what is that larger movement?
That larger movement is just the affirmation that Black Lives Matter in,
okay,
this country,
okay,
despite the narrative that is popular where Black lives often aren't seen as,
okay,
significant. But relationship to policy, Black Lives Matter has actually been successful in the areas of policy.
Okay.
It's just not as well touted as many
and
people
why
don't
is
know.
That?
Well, they have made strides. I think there's a lot of conversation about whether all lives matter, which is distracted from the ways that policy has actually been created.
Uh-huh.
But let's make this known. Black Lives Matter has been successful in creating mandates legally,
uh-huh,
where police officers have to wear body cameras on them at all times.
Why is that not publicized? Why don't people know
they
that?
They have a legislative agenda.
But if you talk to CNN or if you see if any, I mean, when you talk about, when you look,
yes,
at from the media's perspective,
yes,
they don't talk about the substance of what they're doing.
Right.
They just talk about the disruption.
And that mandate is huge. That is actually.
It is. That's absolutely huge.
That's policy. And
yeah,
that's policy.
Is.
And a lot of people do not understand that Black Lives Matter is the one who championed that and made it successful.
Very good.
And so that though you weren't able to vote on that per se,
mm-hmm,
your respective police officers who's surrounding your house or outside right now, he has to wear a body camera if he comes up,
okay,
up
and
on
it's
you.
A paradise. And I just want to get, let me just get her perspective.
Of course.
What do you know about the Black Lives Matter movement? What are your thoughts on the Black Lives Matter movement? I'm just curious as to how Gen Y see, you know, this movement.
I think it's a very
do you understand what they are?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I don't mean to, you know, talk to you like you're a child. I want to meet you where you at, baby.
I'm with their movement.
Okay.
I think that's good. Some of the meetings that I've it was more of the movement, not the organization.
Mm-hmm.
I went to two meetings and they kind of disrupted it, like, okay, the meetings, but they did get their point across. And saying that they...
What meetings did you go to? Do you remember?
I went to a townhouse meeting with the mayor, Eric Garcetti.
Oh, okay, so you were at the one at home and that I was attempting to moderate.
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
And then I went to another one.
Okay.
Yeah. Got kind of crazy.
Got a little...
yeah, a little crazy.
Okay.
But can I speak to
absolutely.
That very briefly?
Yeah, of course.
I want to say this, that Black Lives Matter, the organization, is completely unabashedly and unapologetically Black.
And I love that.
And they want to disrupt the respectability politics that Black people feel that they have to adopt in order to make white people comfortable.
Yeah.
And so respectability is like wearing the tie, picking up your pants, wearing your hair in a certain fashion or style. Black Lives Matter is saying, you know what? If you can't accept me as who I am, then you can't tell me who I am and what I am and whether my life matters. And so when you saw them, unfortunately, at Holman completely, as they like to say, hijack that forum, it was a diverging or a departure from the respectability that Black churches seem to serve in when really challenging the status quo.
And then so what is Black Lives Matter doing in terms of how they're trying to get affiliated with these recent shootings, right?
Okay.
And trying to distance themselves from that type of activity, because that's not what they're all about.
Yes. No,
they're not about killing cops.
But
the press and the media have kind of correlated, this guy's activity associated with the Black Lives Matter movement.
Well, that brother, and I, please, Kenya, cut in at any time. That brother, Micah X, is who we're referencing, I believe. Mm-hmm. He would be someone that I would consider a part of the Black Lives Matter movement, not the organization. He's just a Black man who knows that his life matters.
Okay.
And of course, he would do so by any means necessary, unfortunately, to those whose lives were lost. But at the end of the day, those are still outliers. Mm-hmm. The movement is peace. The movement is love. The movement is unity.
Affirmation.
But ultimately, it's the unapologetic affirmation of Black life.
I love it. And so, do you think that there are going to be more copycats when it comes to killing these cops? By any means necessary mentality of a generation, do you think that's going to emerge?
I mean, I think it's a responsibility of everybody to ensure that there are no more copycats. I don't think that responsibility rests on the Black Lives Matter movement. I don't think.
No, I'm not putting it on them.
I don't think that responsibility. I think that is much of a responsibility as the folks who are standing up, at the RNC in Cleveland right now, saying the things that they're saying from that pulpit, as it is our responsibility as folks and activists who are on the ground. I also want to salute the broader Black Lives Matter movement while they were in their organizational phases. I was in Ferguson on the ground too. Their outcries and pressure that they applied were responsible for the Department of Justice coming in and conducting what we call a dissent decree over the Ferguson department, a police department there.
Okay.
They have also pushed the boundary here, and I've been on several White House calls where they have praised the pressure and said that kind of elevated the need for federal attention on these issues.
Absolutely.
Too. So to me, I think that's a win on the policy side.
Absolutely.
To be celebrated.
So
as well.
What are some of the pages that they can take out of the book from the Civil Rights Movement? What are some of the things that they can incorporate into the movement? Or are there anything from the Civil Rights Movement that can be implemented or valued in terms of the Black Lives Matter movement?
Well, to answer that question, I think Black Lives Matter in 2016 has taken every single page out of that book of the Civil Rights Movement. And they have forcibly decided to write a new entry into that book.
Yeah.
And I think that's what makes people uncomfortable for a new group to write a new entry in the pantheon of civil rights.
The sacred.
The sacred. Yeah. It's almost blasphemous.
Yeah.
But in order,
it's being treated as such.
It is being treated as such.
It is.
But it's audacious. And I think that's what we are as citizens. I think that's who we are as Black people. And the audacity to say, you know what? We have dignity and we have stake in this country, and we will affirm it, and we will write this new entry whether you want to author it or not.
And is there a way that we can get more national coverage on the policies that have been implemented as a result of their efforts?
I think a lot of that is the responsibility of the media too.
Right.
And there is there are counter narratives that exist everywhere. I challenge members of the media to take a step out. And I think that there are folks who did so. Melissa Harris Perry, when she had her platform on MSNBC, was extremely good at having. She was probably one of the first anchors on major network television to have members of the Black Lives Matter movement be sitting on panels and being respected as commentators and contributors and to be able to advance their policy and initiatives.
And Paradise, do you think that there's anything that would encourage you to mobilize youth around? And effort. What are you learning from the Black Lives Matter movement? Seeing how it's once it was started by a hashtag, and now it's become this national movement and this national platform for change. Now, does that inspire you to do anything around your initiative? Do you feel the need to mobilize Gen Y for on behalf of the interests of the Black community? How does the Black Lives Matter movement inspire you as a Gen Y youth?
It has inspired me. I was thinking about having a conference for youth.
Very good.
With some people that just like come and speak and just uplift us, because I feel that the teens, they need to be uplifted and educated at the same time. So I was thinking,
sounds like a junior parlay event to me.
It sounds like it to me.
Sounds like a junior parlay.
I love it.
You guys work that out.
Okay. I love it.
I'll come speak too.
Well, parlay is reaching down to those socially progressive youth. You know, earlier you had talked about in terms of civic engagement, that citizenship is a lifestyle.
Yeah.
Right? So what do you mean by it being a lifestyle?
I mean, civic engagement is a lifestyle. I mean, you know, the final manifestation of being civically engaged is when you go into that ballot box and you close that curtain behind you and you cast your vote, or you do so at the comforts of your kitchen table at home. But, you know, being civically engaged means I have a vested interest and commitment to the community that I live in, that I regularly exercise that in ways of, you know, not just, you know, the typical serving on jury duty and paying my taxes, but that, you know, I also am partaking in community policing, right? I also am, you know, trying to, you know, fill the gaps, you know, where government may fall short in serving the needs
because
of my community.
Because we did used to have Big Mama on the porch.
Yes, absolutely. Right? So it's a lifestyle. So, you know, I encourage Black folks as we exit, you know, I encourage Black folks to understand that, you know, this is not a game.
No.
This is not a game.
It hasn't been a game for
We have to understand that engagement takes commitment.
Commitment.
It takes a heck of a lot of courage. You know, but, you know, if we are so adamant about Black lives mattering, then it's time to make Black votes count.
Absolutely.
And to quantify that in many
different
ways.
You're going to the DNC.
I am going to the DNC.
Next week. So tell us what you're going to be doing at the DNC. Are you excited?
I am. You know what? I am really excited.
What are you excited
to? This is my first DNC.
What are you looking forward to the most?
You know, I am a sponge. I like soaking up all of this information. I'm looking forward to seeing people who I have studied and revered. I'm looking forward to kind of witnessing, you know, the process in real time and watching what it's like on the floor. I am a delegate of the state of California, but I'm not a voting delegate.
Okay.
So I will be able to kind of watch and piece together all of this stuff. And I'm just excited for the experience.
And make sure you tune in on August 3rd because Kenya's going to come back and she's going to host.
I'm hosting
DNC. Recap on August 3rd.
I'm going to give you all the tea, y'all.
So she's going to give us all the tea. So tell people how they can find you, sweetie.
You can follow me on Twitter at kparham, at K, P as in Peter, A-R-H-A-M, or on Instagram at XOKParham, and my website, www.kparham.com.
Fantastic. Tyree, are you going to be at the DNC?
I won't be at the DNC, but I will be at...
You will be here next week on The Dialogue, talking about the Black agenda.
I will be camping next week, but I will come in the very near future. I'll be in the woods next week.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
How can people find you, sweetie?
That was
slick. Of course, you can follow me on Twitter at TyreeBP. You can follow me on Instagram at TyreeBP and go to my website, TyreeBP.com.
And I would be remiss if I did not mention your app.
Yes. So I am an entrepreneur and I have founded a Black directory, a guide to Los Angeles called Black Book LA.
Black Book LA is amazing.
Yes. And you can subscribe at BLKBKLA.com and you can get the newsletter sent straight to you of all the fly.
Tell us that again. BLK.
BLKBKLA.com.
BLKBKLA.com. That sounds like a rap.
It's not. but it's for our community, and
fantastic.
I'm really glad to have garnered 1,600 subscribers in 2 months.
Wow.
And it's aesthetically beautiful,
thank
y'all.
Thank you.
And so this is for anything Black in Los Angeles.
Your guide to everything Black in Los Angeles.
Everything Black Los Angeles. BLKBKLA.com. Thank you, my friend Tyree. And Miss Beautiful Paradise, how can people find you, sweetie?
I'm on social media. Just look up Paradise Oakley, P-A-R-A-D-Y-S-E, and then Oakley, like the glasses. anywhere, social medias, Snapchat, sometimes.
We are so proud of you.
We are proud of you.
Yes,
and
very much, very
I'll
much.
Be talking about it more in the future, but you definitely can see Paradise, Tyree, and myself at the upcoming TEDx Crenshaw in October.
Congratulations, hey, y'all.
Thank you. I'm actually nervous.
We got this. We got this.
Because
I'm going to be right there in the front row.
Thank you so much.
With, like, signs for each of you. Like, woo! I'm going to have signs.
Kenya, thank you so much. Thank you so
thank
much.
You, Starlet.
I look forward to your recap. Even though Kenya is going to come back in August and host her own show on August 3rd, she will be back in October. We're going to do another political series here in October.
We're taking over, basically.
Yes, we're taking over.
Yes,
and thank you all so much for tuning in to the Dialogue Let's Talk Politics. Make sure you tune in next week. We're going to
make black votes count, y'all.
Yes.
Make
yes.
black votes count.
Black
we're
votes
gonna
matter.
Talk, we're going to talk about the black agenda next week. Again, thank you to Kenya, Tyree, and Paradise. And thank you to you for tuning in. And I am signing off as my mama's child and my daddy's baby girl. Until next week, God bless you.
Physical. Truth seeker.